एक आदमी के पास दो आईडी नहीं हो सकता है। वो आईडी जो उसका है उसी में हम ये बी यूनिट जो देंगे तो हो जाएगा, उनको नया आईडी बनाने की जरूरत नहीं पड़ेगा। जिस समय चार्ज में हट जाएगा उस समय वो वाला बी यूनिट उससे हटवा लेना बस, क्योंकि उतने बी यूनिट उससे हटवा लेना हमको बोलते, क्योंकि एक आदमी को दो आईडी इशू नहीं हो सकता है चाहे वो कहीं भी रहे। अगर दो जगह का चार्ज में है तो उसका मतलब दो आईडी होगा ऐसा नहीं है। तो वो जो आईडी है तुम चिट्ठी दूसरा बनाओ, तुम चिट्ठी ये बनाओ कि सानू चला गया और सानू का काम अर्जुन को कर दिया गया, अर्जुन का आईडी ये है इसलिए सानू का आईडी डीएक्टिवेट कर दिया जाए और अर्जुन का आईडी में इतने बी यूनिट जोड़ दिया जाए बस।
Morning, one and all. Sitara welcomes you all to the continuing webinar series. We welcome all the officers and staff of Indian Railway Accounts Department and other departments. Today's session is NPS. This is a very important topic as several employees are now being covered by NPS. And today we have with us Sri P. Rajadurai, Deputy Chief Accounts Officer, General. Secunderabad. Mr. Rajadurai takes special interest in NPS matters and monitors the entire position of South Central Railways on a weekly basis. We are indeed fortunate to have him amongst us. In spite of his busy schedule, he will be addressing this session. Over to Mr. Rajadurai. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Sundar. Thank you, everyone. I mean, good morning, everyone. Sorry for late joining. First, failed some file. Straight away go into the presentations. You require the basic or the fundamentals of the NPS and then move on to the recent changes. Is that okay if I touch upon the basic fundamentals? Am I audible to all of you?
Yes, sir.
So, would you want to tell in from the, you know, what NPS stands for and all these things?
Recording in progress.
Pardon?
National Pension Scheme, NPS.
Yeah. I'm asking you a question that, is that okay?
Yes, sir.
Touch upon the basics.
Yeah, thank you. I think which of the railways are represented today's meeting? Like NR, I guess.
Sir, Western Railway. Western Railway is there.
Okay. Central Railway is there.
Eastern okay. Railway is here, sir. The East Central Railway is there also, sir.
WCR Railway. WCR Railway, sir.
ER, sir.
Okay.
WCR is there, sir. SECR is also there.
So only, you know, having accounts department or otherwise.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Accounts department, CLW accounts, sir.
Sir, MC, primary.
Anybody from personal
department?
Anybody from personal department?
Personal.
Anybody from personal? Sundar, can you tell me that what is the, you know, combination of this group? Is it only accounts or personal
also? No, sir. It is open for all, sir. All the other department people also can join.
Okay.
But maximum, there is no nomination. It is open for all. But maximum are from accounts only, sir.
So you don't basically collect any information related to which of the section in department we are from. I think during our next meeting there can be some kind of like an choose that radio bullet or something to submit that which of the department they pertain to.
Sir, can I launch a poll, sir? One question.
I have a launch a poll like last time we did. Let me see that how many from personal and accounts and how many from other departments. So in the meantime, you make the poll. Then in the meantime, I will start my presentation.
Okay, sir. I will do it in 5 minutes. And I will launch it within the meeting.
How many of you are not in a Telegram group of NPS where we have personals or the officers from Central Record Keeping Agency? How many of you have not joined the group?
Sir, not joined from Mr. Deloitte.
Okay, there are 226 members as on today throughout the zone. That I feel that majority of the people are few of the people are here. I will share here the link right away so that you can join the link and take the benefit. It's a kind of like a instantaneous benefit that or anyone can take by throwing your doubts into the group. This is a group which is a collective group having the members from both Central Record Keeping Agency as well as both railways. This has begun somewhere like last year in the WhatsApp. Then the request of CREA personnel all the problems have been solved almost instantaneously. So they requested to expand the group to all the zonal railways. So I made it open to the zonal railways where many people day in day out they are asking so many questions related to PRAN, related to SOTs, related to intersectoral SIPs. So many questions they make it, and their problems are redressed by the CREA team in almost like 5 minutes to 30 minutes time. Gone were the days that you used to email and then wait for the CREA people reply. This has been this time delay has been greatly reduced. Just
are the kurba ami na hora kunte kurba ami
I have just shared the link which one can join and take the benefit for all these NPS related matters, for which one has to download Telegram and activate yourself, and then you can join this one. As many people join in the group, you will be able to get your problems addressed in no point in time. I think I'm audible to everybody. There is a poll launched. Just please take participate in the poll so that I can understand that which of the which level I can go and make you understand it.
Maximum accounts ka hai, sir.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sir, it is maximum, sir, because those who are logged in mobile cannot participate in the polls.
Can you see the my screenshot related to IR NSDL NPS?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Anybody can tell me? Okay. Can you see the screenshot in front that is called as IR NSDL NPS?
Sir, only PPT.
Yes, sir.
Okay, 1 minute. Now,
yes.
Those who have not joined, just look at this, you know, group. This group is called as Indian Railway and NSDL NPS. See the quantum of message that goes into, you know, every time. Personnel department as well as accounts department staffs as well as officers were invited or invited. This group where they share their doubts. The moment they share their doubts, see something this. One, Mr. Pinku Gupta has sent a problem and the NSDL official has sent it, I mean has addressed the problem with the proper advice. 12:37, the doubts raised. 12:41, they have addressed. Same is the case, Shweta Verma. 2 o'clock, 2:11, the problem is addressed. So it's a kind of like an you know, intense group, more productive group to place your doubt and get your problem solved. It has an impact of learning from others as well. One divisions, one zones staff has a problem, then they share their problem for the rehearsal. Even the other zone, other people also learning from the experiences. So I would request everybody who has not joined so far to join and get the benefit from this.
Ajitore, sir, 6% are from accounts, sir.
Okay.
Only 4% from other departments.
So I would, you know, request Tara to make all its endeavor to reach most. I know, personal branch. I am sure that accounts branch has been doing a wonderful work since from the NPS implementation of the, since from the scheme was implemented. Over a period of time, we have got a lot of experience as to how to take it forward. It's the personal branch which has to learn a lot from this. Next time, you should address it to PCPOs, all the PCPOs of the world.
Sure.
I think they're not.
Sure, sir.
Okay. So let's move on to today's presentation. Reserve your, you know, doubts or clarifications so that at the end we can. Just to have a beginning interactions, I would like to, you know, hear from you. What you know about the NPS. What you know about this NPS? Anybody one by one can just chip in and then say what you have understood from the scheme.
So it's the new pension scheme.
Okay.
Started from
1/1/2004.
Okay.
From 1/1/2004, the old pension scheme was discontinued. And the new pension scheme was introduced, according to which the old monthly pension person. Sir?
Yes.
There is tier 1 and tier 2 in the new pension scheme.
Right.
I think it is actually national pension system.
Right.
And all the government employees have to be enrolled with tier 1 and if they want to exit, they will have to come out of tier 1.
Okay.
And the deduction is of salary and DA, the basic salary and DA, 10%. And earlier it was also 10%. From April 2019, it is 14% government contribution.
Okay.
Tier 1 is, sir, Tier 1 non-withdrawable, Tier 2 is withdrawable account.
Okay. Okay. Is it Tier 1 is non-withdrawable or withdrawable?
Tier 1 not withdrawable.
Sir, Tier 1 is withdrawable.
Okay.
There is some fund manager also.
There are some fund managers.
Fund managers, it is in some percentages.
Tier 2 is voluntary contribution.
Tier
1
is in operation and Tier 2 is in volunteer.
Okay.
Sir, excuse me, sir. Sir, total 24%, 14% government contribution and 10% from salary. This is basic pay plus DA.
Okay.
Total 24% invested in Tier 1.
Okay.
Then, who has joined after 1-1-2004?
Okay. And the NPS is also available for the general public in line with the government employees also.
Yes.
Whereas the earlier pension system was meant only for the government employees.
Okay.
Sir, maximum limit is 50,000 for income tax purpose. They can invest 50,000 per year.
Only 50,000?
50,000 for tax benefits, sir. There is a restriction.
Okay, let me come and do it for some. Anything else?
Okay, sir.
Anyone to substitute anything or compliment anything?
Sir, NPS.
The wording is on the new pension scheme, sir, instead of old pension scheme.
Why the government has begun a new pension scheme instead of old pension scheme?
Yeah.
That's your question? Okay. I will tell you.
Yeah.
I will tell you. Anybody else?
We don't have any benefit, no sir, by putting PPF or anything. Only the 10% of this one and the DA and the going to cut, that's all. We don't have any benefit after retirement.
Okay. Sir, in comparison to our old pension scheme,
the old pension scheme, sir.
Sir,
yeah.
In comparison to our old pension scheme, only 8.33 of basic pay is investing is compulsory, and BPF you can choose, and there is no restriction. There is no restriction on BPF, but it is compulsory for NPS. Sir, like 24% of our basic pay plus DA.
Okay.
That is investing more. That is investing, sir, more than PF, and that amount is managing some organization, that is HDFC, LIC, or some, and they are investing the amount, and number of units are purchasing, and that rate is higher and lower, and there that's an accumulative fund. In that, sir, in that after retirement or at the age of 70 years or death, whichever it may be, the fund 60% and 40%, there is a difference. 40% we can invest for 40% for pension, we may get pension, and 60% accumulative funds to disburse to employee. There is a chance for pension plus our accumulative fund for some amount. But in PF, only interest and amount will be reimbursed.
Right. I
want to add something.
Yeah, please.
Actually, जो annuity खरीदे जो remaining amount है, जो pension जो variable railway variable था जो pension, वो annuity अब pension fund पे ही annuity purchase करके pension दी जाती है. मतलब हिंदी में बोले तो सर समझेंगे आप हिंदी में?
Yeah.
हाँ, सर पहले क्या था, रेलवे बियर करती थी इन एम्प्लॉयज का पेंशन, अब प्रेजेंटली रेलवे बियर ना करके जो उनका अकाउंट अमाउंट है उसमें से 60-40 का जो रेशियो है और डेथ केस पे 20-80 का रेशियो है, जो उसी में से एन्यूटी परचेज करके पेंशन मिलती है, और अगर रेलवे पेंशन दे रही है तो दैट अमाउंट विल बी फॉरफिट बाय रेलवे, दैट एन्यूटी अमाउंट फ्रॉम एनएसटीएल.
So, right, I have heard from, I think many of you have gotten a good amount of knowledge on the NPS, what is NPS and how it works. So let me begin with my presentations. As you go down the line, you will be able to understand and appreciate what you have understood, what you can correct yourselves in terms of understanding this concept. So as many have told, this NPS stands for National Pension System or New Pension Scheme. When the scheme got rolled out in the year 2004, it was called as New Pension Scheme because the pension scheme itself was a new, the modus operandi or the procedure was new, settlement pattern was new as that of the old pension scheme or the existing pension scheme at that time. So, the government of India has improved this new pension scheme for all those central government employees who have joined the government segment on or after 2004. It was exclusive for, excluded, armed forces were excluded during that particular time. But in later, like 2009, even this segment was even open to the unorganized sector or the private sector, by which any individual on paying certain amount of minimum amount, they can open NPS account, at least that 12-digit brand number, permanent retirement, they can open and then they can contribute for towards this scheme. It was a clear deviations or the departure from a old.
Hello.
Yes. Anyone to tell? Anyone to share anything? Okay. So the old pension scheme was to be told as or was referred as infinite benefit system. An employee who gets a superannuation or who dies while the harness of the duty knows for sure that how much of amount he is going to get as pension. As you all understand and aware that under the old pension scheme, the quantum of the pension is decided by your what? What is the criteria of your gauging your quantum of the pension in the old pension scheme? It is something called as NQS. What is that? Net qualifying service. So based on the net qualifying service, an employee's quantum of the pension was gauged, and everybody for sure shot knows that how much of the pension is going to get. So if suppose two employees have joined together in the service, provided or given an assumptions that both of they have never ever availed a leave, or the absence or a leave without pay or whatever it is, wherever the period is not to be counted as net qualifying service. If both are there in the same platform and both have joined on the same date, the same post, they are for sure they will be getting the same quantum of the pension. Whether it is like 25,000, the other guy would also get a 25,000. Wherein, in case of the new pension scheme, this terminology or this nomenclature has changed to defined contributory system. Right? So, defined contributory systems. DBS is meant for definite benefit scheme. DCS is meant for defined contributory system. Why it is called so? That it has a defined structure of contributions, one from government and one from the employee itself. Now somebody will ask that why the government of India has gone for this new or national pension system. is that during the early years of like and this introduction of this NPS is very not, I mean, it's not new. It was introduced way back in 2004. The government of India has very well tried to introduce this kind of like a contributory system of pension way back in the 1970s by introducing a contributory system. But then it was like made as a kind of like a voluntary scheme where employees were encouraged to join. Most of the employees have never joined this NPS scheme. They have opted for old pension scheme, and therefore the attempts for the government to introduce a self-financing kind of like a pension system got scuttled, or it did not take off in the manner that the government wanted. So this was continuing for up till mid 90s. Then later, looking at the various expenditures pattern or the liabilities for the government of India, the revenue deficit as well as the fiscal deficit was quite ballooning, majorly because in addition to the defense expenses, this pension outgo was considered to be a huge outgo which has to be solely funded from the government of India's hand or pocket. The government wanted to shift its burden or to reduce its burden and to make this kind of contribution as a self-financing mechanism which is to be taken care or given by the market forces. So that was the time that this strong idea got into the mind of various policy holders. The pattern of US pension scheme was studied, more or less we have taken most of the provisions of this present day new pension scheme or the national pension system from the model of United States. At that point in time, the number of employees who have come inside and the number of employees who have gone out, but the financial outgo towards the pension was sometimes 3-10 ratio. 3% of the employee joins, correspondingly there is a liability of the government for about 10 times towards the old pension scheme liabilities. Therefore the government wanted that the employees would also contribute, government would also equally contribute, and therefore they have introduced this system to the government's. It was basically to negate the full liability or the full taking on the burden from the government. With respect to the eligibility criteria as to who has to join the NPS, in addition to whatever you have said, there are 2-3 very, very key areas which are very, very important. If one has to ask that whether somebody who is residing in India only can become a member of NPS, the rule clearly says that a citizen of India, whether if he is a resident or even a non-resident, can also join or open the NPS account, subjected to few of the following conditions. Now, what are those conditions? The subscriber should be in the age group of 18 to 65, as on the date of submission of his application or her application to the place where he has to submit. And the second and foremost criteria is that he should be of an undischarged insolvency and should be of a proper form. Not be mentally ill, mentally retarded. Only these people who are complying with this requirement would be able to join. In case of railways, as soon as you join, you become a member of national pension system. There are several features of PS. The first and foremost feature, which is a clear demarcation from the old pension scheme, is this pension scheme is to be called as a pension come investment scheme. By word, it's very clear why we call it so as investment. Whatever amount that you contribute and the employer contribute on your behalf as per the very structure of the NPS rule would be pulled together every month and would get invested in the market through a nodal agency called PFMs, that is called as pension fund managers. these pension fund managers are totally responsible for investing your amount and, you know, multiplicate your invested amount and to witness the money to grow for you on behalf of yourself. So the entire scheme, the pension cum investment scheme, is sponsored by government. Sponsor means 10% from you and the 10% from the government. Which was called as equal contributions when the scheme was, you know, introduced up till 2008. The second feature of national pension system, that it has got two different tiers of accounts. Now, what is this tiers of accounts? Tier 1 and Tier 2. If one has to ask what is Tier 1, Tier 1 is the basic type of account which is very much mandatory. So for all the government employees, including the railway employees, in order to become an NPS employee, you must have to open Tier 1 account. This is called as a primary account, primary pension account, that has restrictions on number of employees as well as the utilization of your accumulated amount, which we say called in the terminology called as corpus. Corpus means whatever amount you make it, whatever amount the government make it, and whatever amount the interest part of the gaining from the market has come. This amount, total amount put it together is called as corpus for this purpose of NPS. This, as everybody said, that this Tier 1 account is very much mandatory. Without opening a Tier 1 account, you can't open Tier 2. Up till April 2019, the employee from the railway, or for that matter, the government of government employee, has to contribute 10% of the basic plus PA from his monthly salary, which will be equally contributed by your employer, that is, on behalf of the government of India. This total amount put together will be invested, is used to be invested in the market. Since from April 2019, the government on the request or the pressures from the various part of the units have hiked this percentage contributions from their part, or that is the government part, from 10% to the 14%, which basically was free. Right. As far as the government employee, there is no concept of minimum contribution of amount in the financial year. But for the private entity, a private employee who has to join, a private person who has to join the scheme, should have a minimum contribution amount. He has to, invest a minimum amount of, say, rupees 1,000 as of now. They have to contribute a minimum of 1,000 rupees per financial year. In case if he is unable to contribute, his account is set to be freezed and it will be reactivated on the request to Central Record Keeping Agency only upon the contribution of the minimum amount. This minimum amount concept is not there with the railway. Once you have opened your account and you have started, there are options for the exit. Now the options for the exit is on a three points. First one is on attainment of an employee's superannuations. Now on the date of superannuations, the 15 days prior to the superannuations, the PTO and the PEO has to do certain responsibilities so that on the day of superannuations, the employee's account will get credited in his bank account about 60% of the corpus that he has contributed up till the period of his superannuation, and the remaining 40% would be exclusively utilized for purchasing the annuities through the ASPs, who are called as annuity service providers. These people would be primarily responsible for paying you the pension. Right? Just a minute, hold on. One. Sir, good morning, sir. Yeah. Sorry. So for all this, all the normally retired employee, the amount of your contribution, the total corpus will be divided into 60% and 40%. Once again, please. Sorry for the interruption. For the superannuation, we have to divide the total corpus 60-40%. 60 will go directly to the bank account of the employee who is superannuating. The remaining 40% would serve as a pensionary benefit for the fund. If in case the accumulated corpus of an employee at the time of superannuation is less than 2 lakhs, then such an employee has an option to complete the problem. Right? So he can withdraw totally also. Why? Because at, when the amount is less than 2 lakhs, the pension that one is going to get is very, very, you know, meager. Whatever your amount plus movement amount and then the earned amount from the pension fund managers, the total corpus for your pension. The amount that you will be getting for the total corpus of less than 2 lakhs is not going to be, significant. That is why less than 2 lakhs corpus these options. In case of death as well as, you know, voluntary retirement or any other type of retirement other than superannuations, the amount has to be divided into 80 into 20 equation. 80% will be a mandatory deduction, which will be, you know, managed by ASPs making you or you mean your dependent pension amount and as well as for the other voluntary retirement also. But in this case, if the total corpus is less than 2 lakhs, then the total amount will be paid to the nominee or the legal heir of the deceased employee in case of the death has happened. If the corpus is more than 2 lakhs, then the 80 to 20 ratio will be applicable as per the PFRD. In case of voluntary retirement, the same proportion of 80-20 is applicable. But the only catch is that there is a change from the 2 lakhs to 1.5 lakh segment for the case of like voluntary retirement. If your total corpus contributions, whatever is available at the time of your exit, is less than 1 lakh, then the subscriber has the option to withdraw that. If it is more than 1 lakh, 1.5 lakh, then this is mandatory of 80 to 20% 20% ratio. way of calculations. Somebody has told that Tier 1 account is a non-withdrawable account. It is not that earlier it was a non-withdrawable account, but the withdrawal, which is called as a partial withdrawal, has been implemented from the year 2015 for all the employees who are covered under the NPS rules as per the PFRDA Act. Initially when this scheme of partial withdrawal was implemented, there was only four reasons on which an employee was allowed to withdraw. Now, for that withdrawal, there were some minimum, criteria. There were criteria as to who is said to be eligible for this partial withdrawal. In order to have a withdrawal, an employee who after joining the service must have contributed 3 years of, the minimum 3 years of service. Only in such a situation, such an employee is allowed to have a withdrawal. And earlier there was earlier there was a rider that once you withdraw, then there must be a gap of 5 years for the second withdrawal. It was that, but very recently the PFRDA or the CRDA has removed this gap, removed this rider. One can withdraw at any time. There is no gap of 5 years. However, as per the present day policy, one can withdraw a maximum of 3 times your total tenure of your subscription, right? So maximum 3 times would be allowed. Now comes what amount I am entitled for when I apply for the partial withdrawal. The existing rule says an NPS employee is allowed to withdraw his own amount to a tune of 25%, a maximum of 25%. You can choose 10% or you can choose 17.5% or so, or you can choose 25. The ceiling limit is 25% of your own contributions will alone be calculated for arriving the amount of your partial. Sometimes question comes that can anyone defer the withdrawal, which means that the final withdrawal at time of all the exit. The answer is yes. Now, the PFRDA has given a facility to a employee who is superannuating at the time of 60 years of age, an option to defer his withdrawal up to a period of another 10 years, which means that up till 70 years, an employee can defer his withdrawal at the time of superannuation just 15 days before. An employee is mandated if he wish sure to defer the withdrawal to submit a form of deferment of the withdrawal from the NPS settlement, and he has to submit this form to his DD board, that is drawing and disbursing officer, generally in Railway Personnel Department or Security Department in case of RPA, right? So when they submit 15 days before, the DDO has to generate a claim ID towards the deferment of withdrawal through his login ID. Given DDO login ID and password, he has to initiate this claim. PAO has to approve it. The CRA will defer the withdrawal. In due course of time, if an employee thinks that, let me prepone the deferment period, that is also possible in the NPS architecture. The deferment basically, suppose somebody is naturally wealthy, and this amount of contribution is not alone a deciding factor for his livelihood, and if that can be from the ancestral properties or any other properties can be managed, then this amount can be can be deferred up to a maximum period of 10 years. The Tier 2 account is totally in contrast with the Tier 1 account. It is non-mandatory, it's totally voluntary. You can have an absolute right to withdraw whatever amount that you have contributed in the Tier 1 account. Unlike in the private sector, unlike in the other instruments where you invest and then at the time of exiting or withdrawing, you are subjected to kind of a commission charges. or kind of like an exit tax type. This menace is not there in the tier one. That is the reason that these days you would see that lot of old pension scheme people started opening this tier two account for the purpose of maintaining the liquidity at the same time to, you know, see that, to witness that their amount is coming. When an employee has submitted a form, EPS form, that is called as version 5.1 of your form, you would see that there are different type of investment schemes. Under this NPS architecture, as of now, we have four type of instruments or the type of investment scheme. They are called as ECGA. ECG, you can say that you can easily remember the test that you are doing to, you know, see the wellness of your heart or good functioning of the heart. ECG, that you can, you know, relate it here. E for equity, C for corporate bond, and C for government, you know, securities, and A for those categories of the instruments which are not covered under the above three categories of the schemes. Right? So, for other than the government sector, especially in the private segment or the private people who have come into this scheme, these people are given a maximum cap up to what amount they are allowed to have this, share in their total corpus. How much of the amount they can put in into equity, how much maximum they can put in into corporate bond or the government securities. The rule has set a ceiling. Say for example, for the private segment, an employee can go up to 75% of the total corpus into equity. Equity is a high risk instrument. So higher the risk, you know, higher the payment or higher the return. That is what the economic concept says. But it has an attributed element of risk. The second one is that corporate bond, in which an NPS holder can go up to 100% of his total corpus, which means that whatever his total corpus, he can totally invest into the amount into the corporate bonds. The third type of scheme is called a scheme G, which is called as government security. These are all assured type of income, because it is assured by the government for their security. They make it to the market to raise the amount from the market for their infrastructural investment or for the infrastructural funding. The government floats this G6 into the market. A private guy can go up to 100% in case of private choose, auto choice. Auto choice, one can go up to 100%. The remaining one can go, one is allowed up to 5%. This percentage is going to differ as you grow, as you gain your age. So when you are in 50 different equity participation than when you are in 30s. So this has been clearly laid out policy. If you see the version 5.1 of the subscribers registration form, at the back end you will see that age wise and the percentage of the equity or the corporate bond contributions. As I said, in the form you will also see there are two types of investment options. One is auto choice and second one is active choice. When the scheme was introduced in the government setup, we did have only an auto choice. This active choice was not there. The auto choice, in that auto choice also, we had a default one. Default one in the sense that when we click that default, we choose three agencies who will invest in certain proportions of our corpus into the market. In the year 2016, the PFRDA introduced, even within the government sector, two more options. They had originally introduced three options under the auto choice, but as of now, Railway has been implementing the bottom two only. The top one of LC75 is not adopted. LC means life cycle. Throughout your life cycle, to your maximum extent of 70% of your total corpus, you can contribute, you can park it in, you know, equities, equity participation up till the age of maximum of 50 years. After 50 years, then the entire, you know, proportions will change as per the set rule of the PFRD. In case of LC50, maximum of 50% of your corpus will go, you can invest into the equities. And in case of LC25, you can go for conservative life cycle, which means that maximum of 25% you can, you know, expose yourself into the market. Now, in the railways, LC50 and LC25 are there. I draw upon everybody's attention who are at present covered by the NPS and who are at the young age of their service. Would you know, quickly see that what of the scheme that you are into, investment option you are into. If you are by default 33, 32, 31% by, you know, UPI, LIC and SBI, I would say that you should now quickly think who is playing smart in the market and which of the LCs I should go for. I would rather say to you that you can very well choose this LC50, that is called as moderate life cycle fund, where few of the players are they are doing, you know, best. In case of active choice, as far as government is or railway is concerned, as of now, we are allowed to the extent of 100% only in the government securities. We are not allowed to, you know, change the ratios into equity and all these things. So far as equity exposure is concerned, yes, we are allowed to go for LC50 scheme or LC50 scheme. This investment choice, if once you are in a default scheme, say for example, if I want to or one wants to change the investment scheme, they are entitled to change at any point in time. This is kind of like a choice, but in a financial year, you can change two times with a time gap of 6 months. That's my point. You understand what I am saying? In a financial year, with a gap of 6 months, you can change your, you know, options from LC50 to LC25, LC25 to LC50, or you can go for the auto to active choice as per your understanding of the market behavior is concerned. Right? The eighth feature of the NPS is to, you know, how tax benefits or the taxes are accounted to for this kind of like an investment by the government. Originally, when the scheme was introduced, it was introduced with the EET, which means that exit taxable. Exempt and taxable. Exempt at the time of you putting in the money. Exempt at the time of when the money is growing in the market through the pension fund managers. Taxed at the time of your superannuation time. When the scheme was introduced originally, even the 60% of the superannuated amount was also subjected to the taxable limit. And then your annuity. Then it got changed to EEE. That is exempt. That means that even the 60% or the 20% of the amount, as the case may be, are exempted from the taxable limit. And the only portion which is taxable is the annuity portion. That means that the 40% of the amount which is being held up by the annuity service providers alone will be counted for calculation of your tax. Am I clear in this? Yeah. So, as far as the section of the income tax is concerned, NPS employees are covered under ATCCD. ATCCD 1, ATCCD 2. ATCCD 1 meant for employees' contribution, ATCCD 2 is meant for employers' contribution. So we have been allowed to contribute to a maximum extent of 1.5 lakhs, put it together, from the employee side, 1.5 lakhs. Later, the government has extended when it was, you know, pulling over the plan to increase the infrastructural investment. they found a way out that let us go for income tax benefit under the year one of NPS employees to another 50,000 amount, where if you contribute to towards your NPS layer one account, this amount is said to be exempted from your overall calculation of the tax purpose. This extra amount of 50,000 is to be accounted for under the section 80CCD1B.
यदि हमने चेंज किया सितंबर में, दोनों चेंज किया सितंबर 20 में, अभी एक साल भी नहीं हुआ.
So when in a financial year an NPS employee can save
12
amount of 2 lakhs rupees under ATCC as against the 1.5 lakhs for other employees. May request the other members to keep the volume on mute. This I have already discussed. Coming to the entire architecture of NPS as to who is actually from the back end, who are all the people who are operating this scheme, is that under the Government of India, the Ministry of Finance has formed a body called PFRDA, that is Pension Fund Regulatory and Development Authority. As the name suggests, it is both for regulation as for the development also. Regulation is in the sense that how the market, NPS market, to be handled, by whom to be handled, who has to be, found to be eligible to, handling your investment, your total corpus of the amount. And the development is that developing a new instruments, new players into the market so that there is a fairly good amount of competitions or the benefit given to the customer, that is the annuity service providers or the for your investment purposes, people should be able to gain more amount from the formidable players in the market. So the basic purpose of PFRDA is to regulate and develop the total NPS working system. Under the PFRDA has approved an agency called Central Record Keeping Agency. This is what day in day out people are in touch with them. The CRA, for the purpose of the government, the National Securities Dealers Limited, headquartered at Bombay, takes care of their activities of the Central Record Keeping of the NPS. As far as the private is concerned, we have an agency called CRA. Now, in order to become eligible for this CRA, there are certain other regulations as to the infrastructures, the networking, manpowers. There are certain set of rules which has to be fulfilled by these agencies who are applying for to become an CRA. Only in which case, when on approval from the PFRDA, they become eligible for functioning as a CRA. As of now, we have NSDL and we have CRB. Right? The NSDL and CRB, in order to ease their working pattern, not to make everything as a centralized manner, but to shell out some of their initial activities or preliminary activities, they have been engaging FCs, that is called as facilitation centers. These are the centers which would facilitate, which would function as a facilitating body to this kind of like the CRA. Now what kind of like the facilitations, the forms which you are going to submit will be first received by the FCs. They will filtering whether all the forms which were submitted by you to them are in a full compliance to whatever or to be complied, whether it has been complied or not. So it's a kind of like the first stage of filtering, first stage of application of the forms. So these eases, the facilitation center eases the total burden of this central record keeping agencies. Right? The main function of FCs are acceptance of the applications for allotment of permanent retirement account number of an employee and the acceptance of subscriber request for any change in their signature or change in the photograph. Right? FC or the NSDL would want your manual or a physical form only to the extent of these changes, that is the signature or change in the paper. for every other changes, the forms which has to be filled in will be parked at the BDO's custody or it will maximum come to the PAO's custody. The only manual form which will go to the CRA is your initial form of plan application form, subscriber registration form, and the second one is any changes affecting the signature and the change in the the CRA is the whole and soul of your total functions of the NPS with respect to the data of the employees or the management of the employees, like registration, dispatch of PRAN card once after the PRAN is generated, the total or complete initiation and maintenance of subscriber record or the choices, and they also are interested in the responsibility of monitoring the flow of the contributions from each and every PAO, I mean every employee under PDOs, under PAOs. Now, the CREA with the DDO's login ID and the PAO's login ID or the PRAO's login ID, one can see the exceptional report that how many of the employees are now. How many of the employees regular contributions have not come for, and what could be the reasons? They will leave these exception reports to the officers concerned to take a call and to review and then investigate on such a lapse. So these are the broad functions of the Central Record Bureau. The third agency, which is the foremost agency or the very critical point of your management of the fund, is called as PFMs. They are called as pension fund. As on date, 8 PFMs are available with this or ROPI or recognized by the PFRDA. They are like SBI, LIC, UPI, HDFC, ICICI, Reliance Capital, Kotak Pension, and Birla Sun Pension. These people are entrusted with the responsibility that during your course of your contributions and while you are in the service, your amount will be invested by them in the percentage that you choose while at the time of applying your applications form. As per the PFRDA's present structure of the rules, an employee can change the PFMs once in a financial year. Right? Once in a financial year, you can change. Today, based on the last year experience, I say that HDFC pension fund has been very well. In terms of 1 year income or in terms of the previous average 3 years income improvement, HDFC is faring well over other PFMs. Then I have an option to shift from SBI, which may be my default pension fund manager, to HDFC. In case if I don't like, HDFC has not been faring well for the particular year and I feel that my invested amount is not growing to the extent that I expected for. But then some other players like ICICI or SBI have been functioning well. You can play with around, but once in a period of 360 days. The fourth agency in the total NPS architecture is called as ASPs, that is Annuity Service Providers. By name suggest, these people are service providers for the purpose of annuity. Annuity is nothing but a fixed sum of amount which you or one would be getting towards the scheme or subscribing the scheme. This annuity, we treat this as an pension once after you enter the scheme. So, these ASPs, with these ASPs, an employee has to go for a signing of a legal agreement. Present structure of the railways, not many of the DDOs or not many of the employees do know that at the time of 15 days before the time of superannuation, I need to apply for ASPs, annuity service providers. So when an employee applies through the physical form or through the online login ID, the CRA login ID, such information will go to the DDO, and the DDO will generate the client PFO will forward, approve and forward to the CRA. Now the CRA will tag your list of ASPs, who your ASPs you chose. At any point in time, one can choose only one ASPs. At present, there are 7 ASPs in the market. Who would manage your remaining 40% of the fund in a manner or in a choice which is available to them? There are different choices under these ASPs. One is to, without having an factoring of your inflation, that is a direct or the fixed annuity amount, then a variable annuity, that is incorporating your inflation. Within this annuity also, one can choose for monthly annuity. Look, I want to not have income saving. My life entirely depends on my monthly, amount only, and therefore I go for a monthly annuity scheme. One can opt for it. Suppose if one wants a quarterly, they can also opt for this kind of like a scheme which the ASPs provide for. Then even the yearly facilities are also there. And there are also other facilities for self. I want for me alone. I do not want anybody for my family. That alone, one option is there. Then for spouse, option is there. Even the spouse up till the death also, there are set of options under ASPs. Now, whether all these options are available to every ASPs is not, it is not so. Every ASPs has a different set of like features available. One has to go and then choose such an ASP which is convenient to you as per your requirement when at the time of your superannuation time. Right? So as of now, 7 ASPs are there: life insurance, LIC, SBI, ICICI, HDFC, Bajaj Alliance, life insurance, and stock. Right? In addition to that, for a private segment, there is a platform called Point of Presence. These are the first shops for anybody to go and get the form filled in and then submit it to them. Instead of the facilitation center, for the private party, this is Point of Presence, the first point of approaching for applying the 12-digit permanent retirement.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes?
Sir, for diversifying our fund, these people take how much money from us?
No money? No money.
Okay.
It's a free of cost for all the government employees. Government employees has to apply and then scan it and send it. Today you have a OPTM's module. Somebody are sending so it is but there is literally no cost or cost element. Right? Only for the private segment, it is up to 500 rupees when they have to open their NPS amount. And then yearly they have to contribute a minimum of 1000 rupees, which I have already discussed. So, as I said, the entire NPS architecture is totally controlled by Government of India through PFRDA. Under PFRDA, CRA, PFM, ASPs functions, trustee bank is the bank who acts as the trustee on behalf of Railway, who handles the entire amount and then submits it to the or credit into the PFMs in the manner that you have chosen. Under the CRA, we have seen there are two types of CRAs, one for the government, one for the private, NSDL and Kirby. Under NSDL and Kirby, we have seen that facilitation centers. In case of private, is called as Point of Presence. Okay. Coming to the overall benefit of ETS, for Railway employee, there is nil cost, there is no cost of any service charges, no cost of any tax or anything for becoming a member or at the time of exit. Absolutely no cost, it's a zero cost for private sector. Service charge cost will be applicable. Second benefit of being in the NPS is it has a power of compounding. Again, it depends on the percentage or the choice of the investment scheme you choose for, whether you choose for LC50, LC25, or you choose for default scheme of 33% as the case may be. all it depends on that where you are putting your money, your corpus, and which of the agencies performing well, where you are going to put in all these matters. So that is why I call this NPS scheme is a DCS, that is dependent on the scheme. It's not dependent. You are, the amount that you are going to earn, you can't define that at the time of exit, I will be getting, say, for example, 2000 rupees per month. It is going to change. It is going to change with respect to the market fluctuations, with respect to the ability of the PFMs to generate, generate and compound your money. So it has a power of compounding. I said that the scheme has a tax benefits, and what tax benefits are there, I have told you. The NPS number, that is the 12-digit permanent retirement account, has a great benefit of portability. What does this mean? Which means that portability means that today I am in the government sector, tomorrow I feel that I no more enjoy my service, let me go to private segment. When I choose this, when I go to, say for example, Tata or Reliance or anyone, at that point in time, I need not to submit my application address for getting into a new 12-digit number. This 12-digit number or the PAN, I can still carry in new segment, whether it's a state government, whether it's abroad the central government, whether it's a body corporate, whether it's a PSU, or whether it's a private sector. Right. The scheme has complete transparency. You know that where your money is invested, who is monitoring, what kind of like a reviews being taken. PFRDA is in the total control. Ministry of Finance is watching the total amount of corpus that is being invested. They watch the performances of PFMs. They watch performances of the ASPs. PFRDA in turn watches three aspects of the three players who are put into the the entire gamut of things. As far as safety is concerned, your money which you have put in, you have a safe mind, because PFRDA is there, PFMs are there, they have been approved, ASPs are there. The only point where which is slightly different from the old pension scheme is the assurity, or the surety, that how much of the amount that you are sure to go to in the pension is the only key factor or the only matter in the NPS. That is why in the NPS, every individual is going to earn a different set of 60% exit amount and a different amount of 40% ASPs. Coming to this, idea that I want to get you through, that how these funds were faring over a period of time of 1 year, 3 year, and 5 years, since the inception of these pension fund managers in the year 2019 and in the year 2020, be very interesting to see that, right? And the first one is both the equity part. When somebody is investing their amount into the their annual return for that 1 year alone, the year 2000, June to July 2015, it has grown on an average of 2.6. 3 years return, it has grown on an average of 3.5. 5 years, 3.74. Since from the inception of the pension fund managers, it is 10.7. If you see the pension fund managers wise, the performance is at a peak with HDFC, right? Then with Reliance Capital, the answer is very, very clear and resounding that these are the players who dedicatedly work in the private segment in the equity. They are so into the equity part of the investment, and that is therefore the return part. So high risk and high return part over here. So the player one, the equity, has performed in the year for a 1 year term of 10.67%, HDFC has been very good. With the reason that I was telling you, that let the beginners go for LC50, take a challenge and go for kind of like a HDFC, or you want to play safe with the SBI, but not much difference, you know, in terms of this HDFC is performed well. In the year 2020, November, you know that the corona lockdown has happened in the year 19th March, and then 20th April 20th, this lockdown was going on. The market sentiments were totally different because so low. Nowhere the investment came forth, the employment cuts were there. So many people in the down the lane have lost their employment. But despite that, this looks a different observations, whatever was published in the Economic Times, that for that 1 year, when there was a huge suffocation in the market, yet the NPS fund could be able to gain a return up at the rate of 7.57. So this is one very important observations for that particular year. Again, HDFC was faring well. In terms of 5 years term, it was going at the rate of 10.5%. In case of corporate bonds, almost the situation is similar amongst the PFMs. It was 10.34. Most of the players were above, all the players were above 10% as against the, equity. So the equity, if you see that, 8.978 from the risky fund. This is for 2020, where the different per annum income was 42. As far as G-Sec is concerned, one will see that it's a totally different pattern. For a 1 year return, G-Secs were earning quite well. But of a different year's origin, different year's pattern, 3 years, it has come down from 10, then 5 years, it is 11.16. These are all mainly due to the assurance given by the government to their securities which are floated in the market. And within the players also, you would see this is for sure, one can easily understand that LIC is a great player in the government security. But it is just because of the huge volume of business they take into the insurance scheme which they invest into the G-Secs. So what is the take from all of this data point is that the government securities is a safe haven to play for it, but if you want to have a quicker return over a period of time, you need to point number one, choose between G-Secs as well as as well. The second point or the second take is that you need not to be in the same pension fund manager because every player would tend to reach certain different set of benefits. One would always top in a particular year. So these kind of players you have to observe in the market their performances and their choices of the choices of instruments that they are investing into the market. You need to be closely monitoring if you want to see that your money has to grow at the time of exit. This is the heads that we compute our MPS. To wrap up, for the basic fundamental part of it, I said it's a government sponsored, it's called as pension cum investment scheme. One has the eligibility to become into the NPS scheme from 18 to 65 years of age. Earlier it was up to 60 years, later on it got extended to 5 years, another 5 years. It has a two-tier account. In order to have the second account, second tier, one has to primarily have or mandatory have the first tier, the tier one account. I said that you have a different choice, investment choice called as auto choice and active choice. I explained what is auto, what is active. You have a different investment options as to asset classes, equity, corporate bond, G-Secs and alternative instruments. I said that the entire performances of your investment amount is linked directly to the market. How the market behaves, how the players are responding to the market, parameter indicators, economic indicators, that will decide the amount of your income growing. I said about the withdrawal. I said that earlier for four reasons it was done. Now they have extended to 7 number of items, and they also, eased the way in which the applications are to be filled and consented. Earlier, one needs to give a PAKKA medical certificate in case if one withdraws, one wants to withdraw on a medical account. That it should be a life-saving, life threat one, and doctor certificate and a preliminary vote. All these were there earlier, time of 2023. But as early as 2021, these all rules have become, they have simplified it. Now it is only declaration, a self-declaration which has to be given by the employee for the withdrawal purposes. But in railways and different zones, we have been following or we have been mandating the employee to submit the reliable documents just to verify for one, the age, second, the beneficiary if they, if they say that for the marriage purpose, whether they are the wholly dependent members of their family as per their family declaration or not. These all things it is being verified, for which we are asking for the additional document. So the decision rests with the local units, local zonal decisions. But as far as BFRDA is concerned or NPS culture is concerned, yes, self-declaration document should suffice for processing your partial. Then I said that you have a lock-in period of your promote finally close at the age of 60. This is the lock-in period where you are considered to be no more an NPS employee, where you can defer your withdrawal for another 10 years, that is up to 70 years, where you completely go out of the NPS architecture or the CRE architecture. So here ends the presentation of mine. In the recent past, we have been witnessing changes that a railway employee who, while doing on a duty, dies or invalidation due to while performing the services or a medical dependence, or the medical decategorization. Now these kind of can come over to the rules and pension scheme. Can come to old pension scheme by completely paying back all those contributed amount to the CRA system, and by a defined affidavit form, they can submit their family members can submit. I do not want to benefit from the present dispensation under this NPS scheme, but I would want to migrate to NPS, on which case we have a rules for death and pension disability on account of death and disability for NPS purposes. In the month of March, we have witnessed central civil services implementation of pension rule 2021. This was implemented by the Ministry of Finance, Department of Expenditures. They have floated this with an effect from operating from March 31st, 2021. This has had a different or definite procedures for how to implement these NPS rules in case of death, in case of disability, in case of compulsory retirement. All this has been incorporated in this rule. As far as this rule is concerned, rule number 10 is very, very vital, or the most dominant or a very important rule under the CCS implementation of NPS rules 2021. The rule 10 says in how an employee or the office has to take forward the applications of the employees and the there are set of two forms, that is form 1 and form 2. Form 1 is meant for which of the option which the employee or the family members are looking for their pension. Form 2 is a form which has which one has to, you know, fill their family details of the expenses. And these forms has to be filled in and submitted to the DDO. Upon receiving this, these forms, the DDO will have to evaluate all the information that has been put in by the employee as well as or the dependent. Once after verification of this, anyone want to raise any questions before completion?
Yes, sir.
Some noises.
Sir, am I clear, sir?
Yes.
Hello. Sir, I am Padmini, sir. Sir, recently the government contribution has been increased from 10% to 14%, sir, right?
Yes.
Sir, may I know the rationale behind this increase in percentage of government contribution, sir?
There is no rationale. It is some populistic policies. There is nothing. Achha.
Actually, this question has been asked in one of the LDCE papers, sir. That's why I just raised the question, sir.
So there is no much rationale. It is as per the government's this one, and as also partially to accommodate your, you know, increasing cost indices.
Sir, please share the PPT in the Zoom chat, sir.
1 minute. I am yet to complete my presentation.
What?
There was a noise in between. That's why I had to ask. If anybody wants to respond. Under the CCS rule of this pension rule, the first and foremost clarity is that this has been brought out by Department of Expenditure by a new caveat that this rule is not applicable for the railway service, which means that railway board has to come out on its, you know, own policies. So the first caveat is that it is not directly to be applicable unless and until railway board clarifies how or the manner in which we are going to implement it. But for all possibilities and the probabilities, we would embrace this system with or without, you know, minor modifications. So I said that rule number 10 of this rule is very, very important. Why it reach at the time of exit, whether it is a super, you know, normal and superannuations or decategorization or any other reasons one want to exit, they need to submit two forms, that is form 1, in which they have to tick that which of the pension they are eligible for it. Under the form 1, the form 1 and the form 2 are under the sub-rule 1 of the rule 10, which says that, the sub-rule 1 says that the form 1 will give you a clear-cut picture that whether you want to embrace CCS pension rule of 1972 or extraordinary pension rule of 1939 for the case of disability or the retirement on account of decategorization. Then the third aspect is that you want to embrace on the NPS pension fund rules. Now, for the death alone, you would come under 1972 CCS pension rule. You have to tick the employee or the beneficiary of the pensioner of the deceased will have to tick CCS 1972 rule, that box, and those who are medically decategorized or the permanent disability or stuffs like that, they should choose extraordinary family pension, and then all other category of the people, including the normal annuation, they will have to choose the NPS option. Like now option will be given that the employee has to immediately choose that which of the policies, which of the options they want to choose. Now suppose an employee doesn't choose and his default option is NPS only, then for up to 15 years from that, from his entry, the date of entry of a 15 years, from the date of entry, 15 years he will be allowed, to change the options, right? Whether to NPS, to whatever it is, beyond 15 years, there is a cap. During the course of your employment, if you choose that I would want, you have chosen that, let me go for NPS route. Suddenly somebody of your friends or some well-wisher say that, all right, you are in the early stage of career. In case sudden, untoward instances happen to you and your family has to rely on completely your own money, then better you opt for, the OPS type of scheme. As the year goes on, say suppose after 20 years, you are nearing to your superannuation, then also you have a choice or the option to change your scheme from that, old pension type to the new pension scheme. So as the year goes on, early stage, what is beneficial is that to embrace upon this 1972 and 1978 pension rules than that of the other. But I tell you again, this is not formally implemented by the regulator. I am yet to come. So, in case at the time of the death, an employee who chose the option as his last one, who exercised his option to the previous last one, that alone will be considered for the determining the settlement of the pension. Suppose an employee did not choose and he has kept the NPS only and suddenly he demise within less than 5 years, then he would forever, for all the purposes, his settlement or the pension benefits will be determined by the PFRDS NPS rule. At that point in time, the family cannot come, the dependents cannot come and to say a state that we have forgotten, we do not know the rule or whatever. They will not be given any option to migrate into the old pension scheme. The best option, whoever are the NPS scheme, is to, when the scheme hit through the railway board, to immediately keep on writing, if you are in an early stage of the career, to choose for the CCS pension rule or the extraordinary pension rule 1972 or 1939. Another one is that by this rule they have given the default option of NPS, which will work up till March 2020, which means that March 2020 is 2020. So it has another 3 years of a gap within which you are to change this option from the default NPS to Default OPS to then. So this is one part of the rule. Then there are several rules for voluntary retirement, for the normal compulsory retirement. There are several rules are applicable, but other than this death and disability, rest of the rules are same or similar for everyone. That they will be following this NPS rule of 60-40, or in case of VR, 80-20 fractions. At the end, this is the broader take from this rule. So the primary responsibility of the PAO and TPO, as soon as an employee joins, or in case of as soon as it is promoted, they have to get an option from every of the employees, that which one will you want to hang around, and then they need to send this form. There will be two forms, form 1 and form 2. There will be two copies of it. One would go to PAO and one would go to CRA for effecting these changes. Right? This is as far as CCS implementation of the NPS rule.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Where will you get the form, sir, if you want to go from old pension scheme to new pension to old?
I said that it is not being implemented by railway formally. The letter that you have seen in the month of March as well as in the month of June, DOE, that is the Department of Expenditure, it has to be implemented for the employees of Department of Expenditure for the other employees, especially for the railways, railway has proper guidelines. As soon as it comes, I'll take you to the forms. You can have a look at it. Just a minute. The screen visible to you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So this is the letter which came in the month of the last week. This one such letter which was introduced by another ministry. First it was introduced by Department of Expenditure, then everybody started department wise they started using it. As per which, of the rule of, I said that rule of 10, sub-rule 1 and sub-rule 2 deals with this form 1 and form 2. Form 1 for availing the benefits, which of the rule you will be coming, CCS rule 1972 or CCS extraordinary pension 39 or any case of EPS, which of the one you will be coming, you have to pick, the option. Form 2 is the family declaration which the employee or the dependent will be submitting after doing filling the application to the head of the organization. In this case, DDO will be the head of the organization and onward submission to PAO and to the central department. The cutoff date is given as 25/6/2021. I am expecting extension from this date from the RIOs. So, this is the format of the form. Option to avail benefits in case of death or discharge on invalidation or disability of government servant or the subscriber while in service. Very exclusive. All things are while in service. So one has to submit this or that as the case. Sign it.
So now whether it has come to railways or not, no sir?
Not yet. Not yet. As per my understanding, it is not yet. It has not come, as per my knowledge. If anybody has seen it, you can comment.
Sir, actually, I have a compassion block where I joined my when my husband passed away in 2000.
Last time itself you came.
Yeah.
I guess you are the same person.
Yeah.
Yeah, help.
So now I just want availments. I'm a retirement age now actually. In 2023 I won't retire, but I want to come give my VR. I'm thinking of giving my VR because of this COVID period and all. So if you want to avail this one, where will I can't avail now, sir, then?
You can't avail even when the scheme comes because you will be going for a VR. The embracement to the old pension scheme will be only on the account.
In case if I have superannuation in 23, can I avail this offer? No, not yet.
Your OPS, embracing to the OPS as of now will be on the two accounts. One is three accounts. One is death or discharge on invalidation, medical invalidation or the disability on the part of it. All of which require either the death certificate or the medical certificate. Towards that effect.
Okay.
I end my presentation. In case anybody wants to ask a question, you can ask. But then, prior to going for the question, I will once again share the link to join the previous group and forward this link mainly to your. OS or the ADM responsibility. Yes, please.
Sir, one question.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, thank you.
It's not audible.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, regarding CCS 2021, item number 17, part 2.
Okay.
Sir, can you please elaborate on this?
I do not have the rule in front. Can you just read out so that I can...
Just it is starting entitlement on boarding of service.
You are not audible. Some noise is coming. Can you copy paste in the chat section?
Can I ask any question?
Yes. No, not clear.
Hello.
Sir, hello.
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, I want to ask something.
Yes.
Sir, आपने अभी जो DDO बोला है, DDO में OPGM जो है, DDO में नहीं है. Accounts अपनी.
I think there is a. Sir, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Sir, may I talk? Hello. Hello.
Getting broken. Actually, I have saved the PPT in the chat box. One can take the second one.
Sir, I want to ask one question, sir. Yes, permit me. Sir, I am from the Western Railway, sir. I just want to ask you कि अगर एक TADAG employee था जिन्होंने जुलाई 2020 में join किया था, okay? But registration form किसी कारणवश हमने नहीं भरा, okay? Now that employee has been demises. Now अब इस केस में क्या होगा सर? उनका registration form नहीं भरा गया है.
It is a total. When did he join?
ये जुलाई अप्रैल 20 में.
July, April 20, and now he
demised. Yeah. Its temporary status has also completed on July 2021, something like that.
Now I'll ask one question.
Yeah.
Can you fill the form and submit?
No, sir.
So when you cannot fill the form and submit, can he come under the NPS rule?
No, sir. मेरे हिसाब से तो NPS rule में नहीं आएगा वो.
So he will never ever come into the NPS
rule. Yeah.
But
I do agree.
But
yeah.
definitely sure for he is sure for an employee from railways.
Yes.
So he has completed his tenure, temporary
status. Yeah. Yeah.
So
yes.
So he is basically a railway employee.
Yeah. Okay.
He has to at the time of the demise while in service.
Uh-huh.
He is entitled for some kind of like a pension, whether NPS pension or the old pension.
Yeah, okay.
Right? Now, he cannot be treated as NPS.
So yeah.
The only choice or the only way is to provide their family the pension as governed under the OPS, that is 1972. Now,
okay.
in the NPS system also, what are we doing while in service, if anybody dies? What are we doing? We are just simply applying to the CRA.
Yes. So,
these employees will be covered under the railway pension. We will be paying the railway pension. Get off all this amount to me. That is the railway. We are writing. We are making the claim ID. CRA on the basis of the claim ID, they return back the money during the interest part.
Yeah.
Then what do we do? We do separate the employee's contribution, the employer contribution, the interest part of it, and then we migrate these kind of like even in the case of the in-between rule came, those who have been selected, their selection has been successfully completed for those posts which were vacant before 1/1/2004. But these of the employees have joined because of the administrative inconveniences after 1/1/2004, but were covered under NPS. They were given a one-time choice to go back to the old pension scheme. The methodology there mentioned how to get back the money and how to calculate the interest component, how to separate it, and what of the amount you need to get it to the EF of the employee, and what of the amount should go to the railway earning. All these steps can be followed in this case, and this is the only way of settling the case. Please don't take much of the time in the provision of the pension, because.
Okay.
1 or 2 months of non-provision of the pension, you are literally, being responsible for bringing the family into the road.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Sir, I just want to ask another question, sir, if you permit me.
Yes.
Sir, एक employee था जो दूसरे railway में था, ठीक है? Now that employee has joined the Western Railway, but वो जो था NOC लिए बगैर वो Western Railway join कर लिया, ठीक है?
Where he was there?
I think वो south SWR में था, Now he is in Western Railway.
Okay.
Okay. आपका क्या हुआ कि उसका दो प्राण नंबर बना, अभी एट प्रेजेंट एक नया प्राण है, पुराना प्राण अलग से, क्या हम उस प्राण को अभी इसे मर्ज कर सकते हैं न्यू प्राण में? Is it possible?
Point number one, you said that something that he is a railway employee.
Yeah.
Point number two, you said about that he has come without no objection, sir.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is not possible. An employee is allowed to migrate to another railway based on the formal transfer letters.
Mm-hmm.
Formal transfer letter. If he is a non-group A employee, if it's a group C or group B employee.
Group C employee.
Yes, the present practice of zonal transfer is through the proper channel of
he is to be counted
as a new employee.
Yeah.
For the purpose of coming into the railways.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me one thing, whether his previous experiences are to be counted for service?
No sir, mere hisab se to nahi.
Has he got a proper, has he intimated the organization?
No.
But in such case, you cannot, merge. You cannot continue the, benefit of having the counting of the service, but I guess in this case he has already has got some amount in the FPS, the one type of brand number. On coming to the Western Railway, he has come to the Western Railway as a fresh employee, but had a earlier brand number. In this case, even if you submit the new, has he got another brand number?
Yes, sir.
I want to ask you that how the NSDL has allowed for it.
ये जो है 6 साल हो गया सर उसको ज्वाइन करके वेस्टर्न रेलवे, 6 साल पुराना केस था. Now it is not possible, I think.
Now it is not possible because the entry system is made in such a manner that your PAN number is uniquely
connected. Yeah.
Connected so that nobody is going to get a second PAN number.
Yes.
In this case, you can merge the PAN number. He can take or transfer the money to his account. There is no problem in it. He was an NPS employee. That is what my perception is. But the rule then, position, there is no rule position as of now. I have seen it. You can join in the group. You can ask in the group to CRA.
May I interrupt, sir? Allow me ask to one question. Sir, NPS में जो nomination है वो father का है, लेकिन जो settlement case आते हैं उसमें wife को pension दी जा रही है, तो हम लोग जो NPS का पैसा है वो किसको दें? क्योंकि nominee में father's name है और pension जो है wife ले रही है, तो ऐसे cases में sir क्या किया जाए?
There is a clear-cut pension rule which says that even if the nomination is on the parents' parents' account, the legally wedded wife takes the whole benefit of it.
Okay.
Okay.
No, sir, sir.
Unless and until the employee has given a share in terms of the settlement. Now, the settlement other than the pension, one is entitled for the death gratuity in case of death of an employee. It is not death. You have a leave encashment, GIS, and that's the only two accounts. And you have a health benefits team.
Sir, I have another question, if you allow me.
Hello. I think you are the same person.
Yes, exactly.
For your earlier question, what I
सर आई वॉज कन्फ्यूज अबाउट दैट ऑल्सो सर देन अगर मुझे उस एम्प्लॉय से एट प्रेजेंट जो एम्प्लॉय वर्क कर रहा है तो उससे मुझे कुछ लेटर मंगवाना पड़ेगा क्या? यस सबमिट एनी लेटर
हेलो आई वांट टू से सर यू कैन मर्ज द प्लान रिगार्डिंग दिस मैटर आई एम फ्रॉम ईसीआर डीलिंग एनपीएस वी हैव आल्सो द सिमिलर केसेस एंड यू कैन ऑफर वन एप्लीकेशन फ्रॉम द एम्प्लॉय एंड देन यू कैन सेंड दैट एप्लीकेशन विद द एप्लीकेशन फ्रॉम योर ऑफिस अबाउट द मर्जिंग ऑफ प्लान and you can send it to CRA and they will merge the both plans. And which of the plan which has a plan have will have more corpus, that one will become the active one. But you should still instead, in case you want now the employees in Western Rail, then you want to just active the Western Railway Railway plan, then you can also request the CRA so that he can active the present plan and reactivate the earlier one, and whole corpus will be merged.
Okay,
we have done here.
Yeah, it could be possible, mean, na?
Yeah, yes, it is
possible. You need to determine which of the plans you want to merge with. And it may so happen that the earlier plan may be a non-IRA plan, the new plan may be an IRA compliant plan, in which case you can say that you can migrate it. The only catch here is that whether a person who has not got any approval and then has come new, whether such an migration is treated to be continuous or not.
Hello.
Am I clear that what I want, what my apprehension is?
Hello.
Yes, sir.
The employee who has exit from the organization.
Hello.
He has literally exit from the organization. When he has literally exit from the organization, then there would be an 80-20 percentage of the share which has to go. And by virtue of coming back to the new organization, he has to, start from the scratch. That is what is the only confusion of mind or apprehension of mind. So anyway, when you join the group or if you are already in the group, when you put this information, you would get a great clarity from the NSDL officials.
Okay, sir. Can I ask another question, sir?
Yes.
Sir, we have lot of questions. So please, sir, ek par aur hum log ke liye ek meeting rakh jaye. NPSPF related तो बहुत अच्छा
रहेगा।
Just a minute.
What would I otherwise alternatively suggest that you can get my email ID and or WhatsApp you can WhatsApp your doubt. What I will do, I will collate everything and like a Q&A, I can prepare and then share it to you in your email. Share your email or in the WhatsApp, whatever you choose to.
Yeah, sir, it's great.
It will be very, very, very beneficial, sir.
That would be, easy to reach everyone.
Sir, please, can I ask another question?
Yes.
Sir, same way में एक और था, वो बिहार में एक state mode में काम करता था employee.
Okay.
ठीक है, अब वो Western Railway join किया है. और सेम में उसमें उन्होंने एनओसी वगैरह कुछ नहीं लिया ओके अब उस केस में क्या हमें सब्सक्राइबर शिफ्टिंग करना चाहिए या नहीं
उसके लिए शिफ्टिंग फॉर्म भरना पड़ेगा
माय क्वेश्चन इज दैट कि अगर उस प्रीवियस एम्प्लॉय जहां था वहां पर अगर कोई रिकवरी रहा तो उस समय क्या होगा फिर कुछ बचा हो या फिर अबंडल्ड हुआ हो कुछ हुआ हो तो
सडन आस्क द एम्प्लॉय टू गेट द एनओसी फ्रॉम द स्टेट गवर्नमेंट ऑफ
नहीं वो बोलता है कि मुझे एनओसी नहीं मिल सकता इट इज नॉट पॉसिबल राइट नाउ
व्हाट इज योर गुड नेम
सर माय नेम इज ओंकेश्वर राव सर
योकेश
ओंकेश्वर राव
या हैंग अराउंड गो टू द ग्रुप ऑफ टेलीग्राम कीप योर डाउट
गेट
योर यू वुड गेट योर अप टू डेट रूल पोजीशन देयर इन 5 10 मिनट्स
ओके ग्रेट सर आई विल डू डेफिनेटली
Encourage all the railway people to join.
Yeah, definitely, sir, definitely.
And when you join, when you participate in the group, after 1 month or 2 months, Sitara will have no purpose in conducting seminar on NPS. Everybody will be expert.
Yeah. Okay. Sir. Okay. Thank you very much. Sir. Thanks a lot.
Sir, excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, kindly, sir, explain the NPS, for NPS employee, the family pension regarding?
NPS family pension regarding is the same rule which the old pension scheme rule is been applicable in terms of your, pension. The minimum pension,
9,000?
Yes. So, the maximum pension?
Hello?
Maximum pension, 1.25 lakhs.
1.2 lakhs. Okay.
In which of the bracket he is, sitting as per the, his eligible qualifying service. That should be calculated and the family pension would be determined in the manner in which 1972 rules provides for it.
But before signing all these things, before confirming all these things, this NPS contributor amount will be drawn back to the railway account and will be duly separated.
Achha.
I mean, will be drawn back to the railway. That's it. In case of those who want to migrate from NPS to OPS as per the allowable rule, then their money has to be brought and then it has to be separated and it has to be parked in the PF fund by duly connecting the GPF rate during the different fund.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
I would really wish that this presentation may be a starting point for all of you, but the real learning starts from that group. The real learning will start in the group, Telegram group.
Sir, can you please share the link of the Telegram group?
Madam, I have already shared. Can you please open the chat, scroll up.
The Telegram group ka?
Yes.
Okay, sorry, sir.
So you have
the
group link. Sir,
I have the email ID. Can you share that? Mail
that
ID,
also
sir?
I have shared in the chat, ma'am.
Okay.
It is at 1.38 hours.
Okay, sir. Okay, thanks.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello, sir. I am Ram Vilas from Yamunanagar. Hello.
Yes.
Sir, recently Railway Board ne 4 June ko ek letter issue kiya hai.
Pardon? Please come again.
Sir, usme the entitlement of family on death of a government servant under NPS.
Okay.
Sir, isme ye keh raha hai ki the pension, the family pension same as under old pension scheme.
Okay.
उसके आगे सर कह रहा है इन एडिशन एम्प्लॉयज कंट्रीब्यूशन एंड रिटर्न देयर ऑन इन एनपीएस पेंशन कॉर्पस शैल बी आल्सो पेड टू द फैमिली मेंबर्स
एनपीएस
पेंशन कॉर्पस
ओके
शैल बी पेड टू द फैमिली मेंबर्स सर एक्चुअली पहले हम क्या करते थे जितना अगर इस तरह के केसेस में जितना पैसा होता था उसको गवर्नमेंट अकाउंट में क्रेडिट कर देते थे
yes.
रिसेंटली सर ये रेलवे ने चेंज किया है तो सर इसमें क्या जो ओल्ड एग्जिस्टिंग हमारे पास डेथ केसेज है ये लेटर उसके लिए भी एप्लीकेबल है या जो 4 जून के बाद जो डेथ होती है उनके लिए एप्लीकेबल है लेटर
एक बार मुझे वो ऑर्डर शेयर कर लीजिए मेरा नंबर दिया हूँ व्हाट्सएप पे शेयर कर लीजिए
क्योंकि सर ये एक्चुअली 2020 की जो पॉलिसी थी उससे टोटली एकदम रिवर्स है
यस एज पर यूर वर्डिंग्स it means that they would get a pension also and then they would get a corpus also.
Employees contribution and plus return there.
Yeah, you just forward to me, I'll just go for it.
Yeah, sure, sir.
Do the correspondence in WhatsApp.
Okay, thank you.
Hello. Sir,
yes.
Sir, good afternoon, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I'm Vijay Kumar from ADF from Bombay, sir. Sir, I have a doubt, sir. Hello.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Sir, once we received the corpus fund from NSDL,
okay.
There are three components in that. One is employee contribution, other is government contribution, and the third one is return on investment.
Yeah.
These three have to be adjusted. It is as for this accounts code corrections level 150, RBE, the RBE 76.
Yes, that is the exact letter where how to do your adjustments. It's been given.
Sir, again, sir, the employee contribution we have to give interest. We have to credit to employees PF account. That PF interest we have to calculate from pro rata basis as per GPF rules.
Correct.
Then how we credit the interest to the PF account of the employee respective account, either through TC, through headquarters?
It is through, headquarters. I am not very clear in it in terms of units.
Sir, I want to share something.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Sir, demand number 13, I think so. The TC and gaining and TC will be credited to employees PF. And GC will be credited to demand number 13. That is government contribution.
I think you see that letter where how to each of the allocation needs to be marked in from there. Somewhere I could be able to see that three different patterns like employer's contribution, employee's contribution and the interest rate part of it, how to account for it. Yes, there is a letter. I know that I have read somewhere, but I couldn't, you know, exactly catch on which of the date and what of the yellow board letter. So give me some time. I think if you people join there, I will share it in the Telegram group only of about the. Many railways have, you know, followed this kind of like a calculation. Our railway also we have done it. I will take one for, you know, calculation and then share it.
Hello, sir. Yes,
sir. If there is any doubt, I would you know, encourage you to come on a WhatsApp and then share your doubt. I will make a kind of like a question and answer, kind of like a Q&A word document, and I will share it to you so that it will be useful to you.
Do you have a WhatsApp number? Please share your WhatsApp number.
Already there, I have shared the number 970-1370-107.
Actually, I am unable to see, so that's why I am asking you again.
Can you see the timeline of 1.38 p.m.?
Okay, wait a minute.
So,
1070-1370. Great, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for your kind cooperation.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I think things are there is a greater clarity now in terms of understanding of this CPS, I guess.
Yes, sir.
Only to the part of like the relations between you and the CREA, that is the NSDL, how or what are the procedures for you know intersectoral shifting? How would I do intersectoral shifting? And when will I get back? Or when will I get back the amount of you know coming back to the OPS and all? You can when you start interacting in the group, you will come to know. No point in time you will go. Right? I think a few of the people would be operating ADF and NPS account when you are operating that. If you are operating with the login ID of the ADF, see that the exception reports in the group, also the grievances, online grievances. There is one more part called as FATA declarations. These are all the declarations which are now being mandatory for even those old people also. These are all the document or the information which you need to give or the employee should be encouraged to give online. There is a way or how to give the FATA complaints. FATA is that US, you know, United States of America's some complaint has to do that. That has now become mandatory, like an email or a mobile. So just go that exceptional report, download pertain to your PO account and see that like how frequently or is there any break in contributions from the employees. You know? If there is any employees break in contributions for you know, more than 3 months or more than 6 months, you need to take a prompt corrective actions putting up to you know your junior AFM or the PFA as the case may be. In word to personal department to take a disciplinary action for such you know unauthorized absence due to which the previous contribution is not coming. So thank you so much. I could not you know,
sir, one doubt, sir.
Yes.
Sir, after the retirement, how will we get the settlement of NPS, sir?
One by way of your direct transfers to your bank account, madam. About the 60% of the amount, which is the total corpus of 60% of the corpus, just before retirement, 15 days before you reach, to, you have to reach your DDO, give it in writing that I am going to retire in this month and I want to choose this as an ASP, this fellow is an ASP, then they will initiate, you know, they will generate a claim ID awareness that superannuation. That such and such employee would want to choose SBI as an ASP in which CREA will in a further link. You need to personally, you need to you know enter into a formal agreement with the SBI or HDFC as the case may be choosing. And then once after the agreement is made, it is the dual relationship. It is the relationship between you and your you know ASPs. you will not come under any of the CRAs. In case if you have any grievances during the operation of the ASVs, your only grievance point of redressal is PFRD.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. You want to conduct one more session, interactive session, date provided to you. Yeah, we plan in 1 or 2 weeks, sir, one more session on interactive. Thank you, Bhavav Sitara. Thank you very much, sir, for patiently addressing all the queries raised by participants. I thank all the participants. Sir, if possible, please share PPT in the Zoom chat or else please share to my email.